Bonjour, my name is Jacquire King, and welcome to La Fabrique Studios here in Saint-Remy, France. The June seminar at Mixed with the Masters 2014. We have some questions that we're going to go through, and I'll try to answer them as best as I can. The first question comes from AJ Steele. How do you deal with aggressive sibilance in a vocal if you can't recut the track? Answering the question without actually hearing the track and knowing how much frequency content the vocal has overall, I might take a gradual approach. And I would imagine that if the vocal was recorded in such a way that maybe it doesn't have enough low end. So I would probably compress the vocal first with just an LA 2A type of compressor, maybe an 1176. Probably something tubey to warm it up a little bit. And then I would use a de-esser, but where it's split, so you're just dealing with the high frequency. And I'd probably address it very high, maybe 8 to 10, 12K. And then depending on how much effect that had, I might then look to compress the vocal again, but maybe more in a limiting style, but gradually, not overdoing it at either stage in the first compressor or in the maybe the secondary compressor sort of limiter. And then if I felt like I still had too much sibilance, I might then do a full, use a second de-esser after the second compressor, full bandwidth, and maybe just try and find the magic frequency on the full bandwidth de-esser that helped me with the final bit. So thanks for the question. This question is from Daryl Swart. Thanks for your time. Totally cool. Love your work. Can you explain the use of distortion and overheads that I read about for mixing KOL, Kings of Leon? Is it on a parallel? How much distortion? First, I didn't use any distortion on the overheads. I did use distortion on some of the room mics. And on the room mics, I would have used the lo-fi plugin in Pro Tools. I also, so that's what that would be. And part of the reason that I like to use the lo-fi plugin and add a little bit of distortion on it for the room mics is to take the cymbals down a little bit, because as you take the frequency down, the bit depth down, you can change the aliasing from 100% down towards 60%, I guess, and it'll reintroduce some of the high end back into it. I like that effect on room mics, especially where you have a lot of washy cymbals. And then other types of distortion I use on the on a parallel for drums would be, sometimes I do a mix of kick and snare and maybe some other element that I think is appropriate for a sort of an aggressive sound. And I'll run it into some mic pre's, like Neve mic pre's. So you're getting a pretty distorted sound and then blending it in underneath in parallel. Running a signal into a mic pre is also a good trick for creating a little vocal distortion or anything you want to distort, and then just kind of blending it back in parallel. Thank you for the question. This question comes from Jonathan Thomas. Hi, Jacquire. When processing drums in parallel with your levelers, for example, are you sending the whole drum bus through them or just selected elements in varying amounts from aux sends that need some extra oomph, example, snare or room mics? Thank you. The levelor, just as I described for the previous question, the levelor is often a choice I'll make for a kick and snare blend for the drums and blend it in there, because then the levelor is very distorted, but it's a compressor or limiter depending on which setting you're using. So that's another way that I do it, but I do send a very specific blend, and it's usually just the kick and the snare, because doing more than that. You're just getting too much leakage from other elements of the drum kit, and then it ends up sort of working against you and not being very impactful. So thanks. That's two good questions kind of tied together. This question comes from Alex Lima. Would you still use tape from time to times when tracking? If so, do you transfer to Pro Tools right away or reuse the same tape? Good question. I do still occasionally use tape for when tracking, but not all the time. It's become less and less because just the state of things, from budgets and time constraints, not being able to afford the tape, not being able to afford the time in the studio for that process where you have to take extra time to make sure that the transfer is good and all that stuff. So, because you're basically playing the song back twice to get it transferred in. And with the Dawes record I made a year and a half or so ago, 2 years ago, we tracked everything primarily to tape, and then before we even transferred, we'd get vocals and overdubs before we transferred. And I do it right away. I don't, after we've got all the takes we need, I do the transfers, and I'll do the edits. If we are compiling takes to make a master, I will do the edits in Pro Tools, and yes, we do reuse the same tape. And part of the issue with tape these days is the inconsistency in its manufacturing. So reusing a tape for 4 or 5 songs, I mean, you can get a lot of use out of tape, is the way to go, because you know that the tape machine is set up for that reel of tape, and then when you feel like you've got enough use out of it and you move on to another reel of tape, you can then check the calibration and just begin the process all over. Dylan Seals. Hello, Jacquire. When working in an unfamiliar studio, what is your process to acclimate yourself to the monitoring and control room acoustics? Well, it's a good idea, first of all, to always be working on a pair of speakers that you're familiar with. And I use Pro X quite a lot when I'm tracking and mixing. I also always use a small pair of KRKs. I like the Rocket 5s. They're a speaker that appeal. They make sense to me. They have a lot of low end and good low end at low volumes. They're not really fatiguing to listen to. So having a good pair of speakers, things that you can be familiar with. And then I listen to some of my work, some of my other work. I don't listen to mastered work. I listen to flat mixes, so not stuff that has not been leveled up, to make sure that I feel like I'm hearing my speakers in the right spacing in relation to the depth of the console and where I'm sitting and working and the room, and making sure that things are kind of making sense. But even when you do that, every room is going to be a new room to you, is going to sound unfamiliar. And because I do move around a lot to different studios, even when I go back to the rooms that I'm familiar with, there's an adjustment period. But something that I do that sort of helps me along the way, initially kind of get my feet wet back in a room, is making rough mixes and then taking and listening to those rough mixes at home and on headphones. And then you get a sense of, well, this has too much bass, not enough bass. Kick drums, the snare drum's really loud or not loud enough. And then, so when you go back into the studio the next day, you're starting to tell your brain what will make sense. And that's how I deal with that. This question is from Doug Brown. What is your mix bus chain these days, and how much do you rely on mix bus compression to achieve the final result? My mix bus chain these days on the stereo bus, I always use a Sontek EQ, and I typically daisy chain two EQs together. For a while there, I was using a couple of quad 8 mic EQs, and just using them for a little bit of high frequency boost. I like to EQ my mix bus because, you know, instead of adding 3, 4, 5 dB of high frequency to everything individually. I like to just get a head start and put a nice curve. I balance the mix, and I just balance the mix without doing a lot of treatment to it. Just kind of get a rough idea, make sure my gain structure looks relatively in a decent starting place, and then I'll EQ with the Sontech, kind of a specific thing, clean up the bottom end, control the mid-range a little bit, open the top up. And lately, I've been in a habit of using two EQs for various reasons. But it's sometimes it's because of the style of the EQ and the sound of the EQ. And then the compressors that I like on the stereo bus are a Neve 33609. I have a pair of modified 2254s that I have used for a very long time, which would have been the I'm just thinking Kings of Leon because of the previous question, but I would have used that compressor on the stereo bus for those records. And then lately a friend introduced me to the Obsidian. It's Dramastic Audio Obsidian compressor. It's an SSL style compressor that has more fidelity. I like what other people do with SSL. It's not necessarily my first choice, but I like the action of the compressor, and it can be quite good. But this particular compressor has a little bit more fidelity to me, especially in the extremities, the top and the bottom, and so that's my mix chain. It's primarily the Sontech EQ and the Obsidian. And how much compression do I rely on? I don't want to see, in general, I don't want to see the mix bus compressor doing more than a couple dB of compression. And just on the kick drum and the things that are really, really loud and sort of very present in the mix, I don't want to see the mix bus compressor always in compression. It's just sort of like gluing things together, just ticking it down just a little bit. So thank you. Victor Adura. Hi, Jacquire. Was there any really unusual piece of gear you used in Only by the Night that helped achieve that sound? No, I used mainly Neve. I would say the majority of the input channels were Neve. Did use some API. The Chandler TG2 on Caleb's vocal, Vintec pre's, which are very much like a Neve, APIs on guitars, an unusual piece. Not particularly that I can think of. There wasn't really any one particular thing that I used as a specific color that guided the whole thing. It is just sort of a combination of things. So I wish I could be more specific, but there isn't anything that gave me that sound. It was just sort of a combination of great songs, great studio, great band, we just really all hit on something pretty special. I think that if there's one thing that I could say now, to think about it, because it's not necessarily a piece of gear. I think part of it has to do with the way I could set the room up with the band and utilize the chamber in Studio D. We made it at Blackbird in Studio D. I think a lot of the cool part sonically of the record is the use of the chamber on the drums. And the chamber, just to explain, is the control room. You have to walk through the chamber to go out to the live room. And often the chamber is used, there's a speaker in there and we mic it, and often the doors are closed and you'll send something out there and use it as a traditional chamber. But because it's right next to the live room, I often leave the door open some and mic the drum ambience. And there was various room mics, but that's definitely, that chamber is a color that I use as often as I can record there, and it's definitely a big part of some of the drum sounds on that KOL record. Thanks. This is from Lewis Amkilla. Jacquire, what is the best way, in your opinion, to make vocals as thick as possible in the mix? Well, I almost always use some micro pitch shifting. It's the Eventide effect that I used to use in the H3000, and then Soundtoys has the pitch blender plugin. That's what I use for that. I just detune plus and minus 5 cents. So I use a little bit of that. I also use the Dolby A trick, where you use encoded Dolby signal for a hyped high frequency signal. You can do it with an oral exciter. It's a similar sound. Using the Dolby, it's a little bit more of frequency expansion, especially in the high frequencies. So those two things I feel like really, really help give the vocal a width and a little bit of a extra hyped texture. I have fortunately own a really great Blue Stripe 1176 that I don't know that I, if there was one piece of gear that I have and I could only keep one, that would be it. It's pretty special. I run it pretty hard on the vocals. I use it in 4:1. I use the lowest ratio, and I usually compress with it up to 15, maybe even 20 dB in the mix, but it's not on all the time. It's sometimes the vocal. It's a very transparent, very forgiving, but very aggressive and compressor. You can do it with other, you can absolutely do it with other compressors. That one really works very well. And the, not only does the Universal Audio emulation of it, but the CLA emulation of it, they both work really, really good. I like the CLA emulation. It seems like Chris's 1176, the Blue Stripe, is very similar to mine. And then I set up a couple delays for the vocal, a couple reverbs, different reverbs, different times, but on the reverbs, different textures more than time. I usually find similar, the time ends up being about similar sort of decay time, but different texture so that I can, because I automate my effects quite a lot, especially on the vocals in the song, so that I can sort of create darker or brighter ambience. And then I do delays that have two different times, one shorter, one longer, similar thing. I automate them. You know, sometimes I turn them off, sometimes in sections and bring them up and just push up the longer delays on certain words. And that's how I do it. Thank you for the question. This is from Patrick Frost. How did you capture Nora Jones's vocal? How much of it did you commit right away at the tracking stage? I captured Nora's vocal with, she owns a Telefunken Elam 250, and that was the primary mic that we used for her vocal. And I also used Placid Audio? It's the Copperphone mic. And I used it next to, I just put it right next to the 251 and cut it for the whole time. And there is some measure of it in all the vocal sounds on that record. I compressed that microphone quite a bit because it has a very it has a very narrow frequency band that it captures, and so as someone singing, it can sound very erratic. So I had to definitely put a lot of compression on it and EQ to balance out for the different vocal performances, whatever I needed to sort of adjust for that, so it would have a very consistent sound. It kind of has, in the texture of the vocal performances, it kind of just gave it a little bit of a gritty, high frequency sort of whisper sound that I could kind of blend in a little bit and kind of make it cut. Nora has a beautiful voice. It's very warm. So having that to play with was helpful. So I definitely committed all that EQ and compression on the Copperphone. On the 250, I usually cut vocal. I used a Neve pre. I usually don't EQ vocals to tape. I don't want to paint myself into a corner, because if you choose the right mic pre and a good compressor, you should be okay to make any equalization adjustments in the mix. And I used an LA-2A, a Teletronics LA-2A, for the compression. And I'm not afraid to compress a tracking vocal, at least with an LA-3A or an LA-2A, a pretty decent amount. I don't leave all of my vocal compression to the mix. I try to be as brave as I can be with it when I'm tracking. Thanks. Anthony Pilato. Hi, what are your favorite plugins and which instruments do you use them on? Thanks. I would say probably my all-time favorite plugin, because I use it quite a lot and on most things in some measure, is the George Massenburg EQ. I think it's a really tremendous sounding plugin. I honestly, the way it sounds to me, to my ear, is that even just by putting it on, it improves this clarity of the sound just a little bit. Digital EQ and plug-in EQ is a very tricky thing in terms of how much high frequency. The more you use digital EQ in really broad strokes or like a lot of change, that's where it starts to sort of fall apart a little bit. And digital EQ is usually the weakest in the high frequencies, but the Massenburg EQ is really, really quite good and stays pretty sweet up through the higher frequencies. I like several of the different 1176 plug-in emulation, Universal Audio. I like them quite a lot. I use the Blue Stripe one of theirs quite a bit. I like the Bomb Factory one. It's still. I use it on things occasionally. It's pretty good. Sometimes I use it on background vocals, overhead. Find myself using Vintage Warmer occasionally. I think that's a good plugin, very flexible. I use a lot of the Universal Audio stuff from time to time. The Transient Designer plugin is useful. It is not. It's not the same thing as the hardware, just in terms of sound and action, but you can achieve the same job. It'll do the same. If you need the same sort of, if you need a tool to do that job, the plugin will do it. The Waves, I can say one plugin that comes to mind that is new that I really like is the Waves Real ADT. There's nothing, everybody should check it out. They've done had a great opportunity and done a really good job with that plugin. You can't get that sound from anything else, so it's really cool. I try to use as much real hardware as I can. Let's see, Lo-Fi. I think that's a plugin that's been around forever, and it's very useful. The Sans Amp plugin's great. The Valhalla reverbs and those things are cool plugins. So that's what I can think of off the top of my head. Thanks for the question. From Richard Broom, what Pro Tools multi-track converters do you use? Does it make a difference to make the move to more expensive solutions out there, the Burl, Prism, Apogee? Do you use sophisticated clocking solutions? Okay, well, I think there are many good converters out there. The converters do make a difference, absolutely. And a good clock is, I don't have an Antelope, but a good clock is definitely essential. Often I'm satisfied, you need a good clock when you record, but for sure you need a good clock when you mix. I think that the Big Ben is a great, I'm very happy to have that clock when I'm tracking. I like the Apogee converters. I've owned lots of different Apogee converters. My mixing rig is still primarily the Apogee AD 8000 Special Editions, which means I do have to mix at the lower sampling rates, but I like that. I think that's good. Don't always record. I don't always record at the same sampling frequency. I mostly mix at 48, often record at 96, and downsample before mix. Some people do it the other way. I don't know. That's just for me. I like it that way. The Lynx Auroras are good converters, which I have. The new Apollo converters are really nice. I use on my stereo bus. I have been for a little while now, mostly using the Universal Audio 2192. I have a PSX100, which I used quite a bit, which the Kings of Leon stuff is the PSX100. I do have some friends that have purchased the Burl Motherships and listened to them. I think they're pretty extraordinary. I'm considering them, but I have so many good converters now. I'm sort of trying to weigh it out. But absolutely, a quality converter is essential, especially if you're going to record a tape and then transfer. But no matter what, a good converter is essential. But perhaps the clock is even more essential, because a great clock can make mediocre converters sound better. Because if you have a mediocre converter, the chances are that they didn't spend more money on the clock in particular for those units. So you can improve the sound of something just by changing the clock. So thanks. And this question comes from Jens Anderson. I hope I'm saying that right. When mixing in the box, would you sum out of the box? How much difference does it make? I think it makes a great deal of difference to sum out of the box. And yes, whenever I can figure out a way, I will always sum out of the box. Now, not to say that I don't submix in the box, because I do. I submix quite a bit in the box, and often use quite a bit of the automation in the box. But just in terms of, I want to use analog EQ and compression on my mix. I feel like it's better for the image. It's what I like, especially a good analog EQ like a Massenburg or my Sontex. So if you can figure it out, even if you just use a small little Mackie mixer, I think you just get an improved image and not listening to everything come out just a stereo pair of converters. It just, even just in a listening way, it gives you a bit more clarity. And you're not, when you're stemming things out or to do the external summing, you're getting the advantage of having a little, because in mixing you're trying to get as stout of a level as you can. So to just push it all out, a couple of converters, even if ultimately you make a digital bounce, you're listening through two converters. And the more you're demanding of them, you're up in maybe the headroom of what the converter is capable of doing and its sound quality. So I do think it makes a big, big difference. And then also some of the things that you need to do with the gain staging at the end, there is really an advantage to doing it analog. And yeah, it's definitely my preference. So that's all my questions. Thank you, and I hope to see you at a future Mix with the Masters. This is a great place, and it's been a great group of guys. It's a wonderful facility. La Fabrique is a really great studio. The environment is amazing, and it is a once-in-a-lifetime experience. I have enjoyed the group of people that I've had here, and spending the time with them. We recorded and mixed and hung out, ate, talked. It's been a really, really good time. And so maybe I'll see you here in the future. Au revoir.